Okay. That routine originated right in my living room.
Watching Arnold Schwarzenegger.
In about 20 minutes of thought. But it had a history. Okay. I love the way I was posed because I tried to mimic John Brown. And mm-hmm. I thought it was just perfect what he did. The style, the art, the communication skills he was using. Learning how to pose. Not just up here throwing around and looking for applause and doing all this crazy stuff, you know. It was like, give you a reason to clap by doing something, and then that's fine. Give me a reason to connect with you. And I remember John was telling me about that earlier. When I want to connect with my audience, that's what posing is about, communication. I give you that look, you know. I give you that contact. Yeah. And then I give you that one time, just to let you know I'm with you. Can I hear you? Okay, that's cool. Yeah. You know, and then we create something. Well,
bit of Luther Vandross.
Oh, when the great, when the great. Oh my God!
If this world were mine,
John knows all my stuff, man.
I will place at your feet all that I own.
You've been so good to me.
The floor poses.
This world was mine.
The floor poses.
Yeah.
That song came apart. That song just traumatized me the first time I seen somebody move, use it, and use it, read it, and feel it. Mm-hmm. When John asked me after I saw him posing in Berlin, about a year later, he asked me to come to California to train for a little while. I said, okay, I'm gonna come and learn how to do bodybuilding. So when I got there, one of the things we did, John was going through some posing courses with me, telling me how to pose, you know, showing me these different things, what I should and should not be looking for. Then he set off because he was getting ready to compete in the Night of the Champions. And I remember him having some issues with Tony Pearson as far as who was in and who wasn't getting in. One slot was open. But anyway, John was posing. He said, Taylor, watch this. I make the ladies cry with this. I'm sitting there. I'm goo-eyed, you know. Like, what are you going to do? So he puts Luther Vandross on. Cheryl Lynn. Oh, he started doing the moves. Bam. I'm thinking, look. And the way he was moving, that just went right in me. Okay. That's why I said, that's the way I got to pose. Now, we'll speed that up because that was a dramatic posing.
Yeah.
It's very communicable how you're moving, and the music moves you. That was the key.
Something you and Kevin Lavrone both did that you never, ever see anymore is you posed with your hands in your face.
Yes.
You made it part of the performance. It was like you were a performer on stage, like an actor, like the way you'd be like feeling the music, and you don't see that anymore. You see guys moving their bodies, but you don't see them really getting into the music. And it was like a full body kind of, it was a completely different experience to someone just flexing their muscle.
And I got that from John. John told me from day one. He said, Taylor, you got to understand, you have to send signals. You have to direct people.
Yeah.
So when you're doing a move and you just throw something together, that's nothing. You throw it together, but you follow it through, for example, just by the hands. He kept telling me, throw the hands into it, make a move, you create attraction, and they're going to follow that. Okay, so he says, that's what I want you to do. While you're doing this and you're showing an emphasis, while you're expressing your movements, but at the same time, you're setting up the other pose. You're not leaving an open space. So while they're watching something here, you might be getting ready to set up a onside bicep shot or something. Most people don't do that. They go from whatever pose they are straight to the next one. And they're moving around. There's nothing coordinated or quality about that gap between A and B. Transition is important. This is a transition setter, and when people see you doing that, they follow. So that's the key to the moving that hand and getting you in point.
One second, new pros.
You got it.
New pros, listen to this, watch this back, because I'm telling you, you can learn a lot from guys like Vince Taylor, Lila Brada, Sean Ray, John Brown. These are the pioneers. We need to bring this style of posing back.
I agree.
Do some of the pros contact you for ask you for
that
posing advice?
That picture was awesome, man. I can see myself right now on stage doing that because when that song came on,
KLF.
Oh, vengeance approved.
Yeah,
now here's the answer to your question, guys. What had happened was, we were watching the Arnold Classic, my wife and I.
Yeah.
And I give my wife all the credit in the world, guys. She was my nutritionist. She was my trainer.
Wow.
She was my consigliere. She was my boss. She's everything. She did it all for me, okay? It was me, myself, and I, and her. I didn't have a trainer. I never had a training partner. It was just me and her.
Yeah.
So we were sitting down, and she was saying, you know what? Don't like the way you guys pose. You know, so okay, because women are very exciting. You go to a bodybuilding competition, it's so boring to see you guys running from one, two steps, muscle shot, one, two left, muscle shot. You know, you do the same crap over and over. That is so boring, guy after guy after guy. Be more entertaining. So I'm like, okay, that sounds pretty interesting. And then something, lo and behold, had happened 10 days before this conversation. I was out doing an exhibition. I came back home here to Florida, and I was told from my good friends, he says, man, your buddy Sean Ray was in town at the local gym where you trained at, too. I was over there talking to Sean, and, you know, and I asked the brother, you know, what do you think about Vince? And he looked at me and told me, once beaten, always beaten. He's no competition.
Sean Ray always talking.
Yeah, right?
So shy with his words, isn't he, Sean?
Always talking.
That's it. I'm thinking, love it. Well, you know, you got a point there. I didn't, my boys was pissed off. They were like, man, he come down here dissing you like that. I'm like, well, you know, truth, I haven't beaten the guy. You know, I don't really go after anybody, but I haven't beaten the guy. A couple of days later, Lila Brada's in town. At that particular gym, too. Okay. The question came up again. What do you think about Vince Taylor?
Says the same thing.
He goes, he's not any competition for me. Oh. I said, okay, I don't know Lila Brada either. You know what I mean? But now you're in home talking trash, okay? Now, we're getting ready for this competition coming up. So we're sitting around the home, my wife and I, and it was like, and that conversation about posing came up. So I wanted to change my posing. And when we saw, I'm thinking, what could I possibly do? So I'm looking at TV, one of the dance shows at the time, and this guy comes out. His name was DJ RoboCop. Okay. The brother comes out with some sunglasses on top of his head.
Is that his real name? Right?
No.
DJ Robo, you know, thinking, okay. So he comes out, guys, and he's walking, you know, he steps on the stage, and he's making sound effects with his mouth. Right? And he's like, and he's going like, put the glasses on. Then he started going, I'm like, that's cool. So something just stuck with me with that. Then I was a couple minutes, I was switching channels. The Predator was on with Schwarzenegger. And I'm watching The Predator, and then we was watching Terminator. Both of those things came on. And all of a sudden I saw Arnold go inside of the club. And he's searching for Sarah Connor.
Ah, okay. I see. Piece it all together now. I see.
So I'm thinking to myself, and this is happening like we're talking right now.
Yeah.
I'm telling my wife, I'm like, he came in and he's looking for Sarah Connor. What if I came in
looking for Sean
and I'm looking for Sean Ray, you know, and then I want to extend it, Lila Brada. And then Haney, you know, like that. We're going to terminate somebody.
Yeah.
So he said, That's pretty cool. But how are we going to set it up? As you know, posing has – everybody has a certain direction. So my thing was, all right, well, let me – since I'm a Terminator, let me terminate them. But let me find the right song for each one of those guys.
Yeah.
So that's where the little bit of work came in, 2 minutes worth of work. So I was sitting there, I'm thinking, all right, Lila Brada – I mean, Sean Ray was first, once beaten, always beaten. Okay. So I need a song for him. And I heard KLF, 3 a.m., and it was banging. Yeah. I mean, when you hear that, bam, it was like, wow. You need an explosion song on stage when you were trying to get people off and rocking. That I know. That's why I use slow and fast songs. Mm. But that beat, that song, 3 a.m., KLF, was like picture perfectly made. And the words were vengeance approved. So you know, Sean, I'm after you, buddy. So that was for Sean. So then we were sitting there. I said, what would you do with Lila Brada?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm thinking to myself, oh, he's, I ain't no competition. Mama said, knock you out. I mean, that's no. And when I heard the lyrics of L. Cool J, it was like, picture perfect. So I got this portion of the song chiseled out. I chiseled out the lyrics for Lila Brada. And then it was, well, you're a Terminator, but you're not stupid. Okay, you got Haney over here now. What you gonna do with Lee Haney? You gonna take Haney out? No, that's never gonna happen. So pay homage. This is your idol. You know, hey, give the brother some respect. That's Mr. Olympia. So what can you do? Then you started seeing the movie. I'm thinking of him running into Arnold in the police station and turning around. I'll be back. You know, that was a thing. I'll be back.
Yeah.
That was my thing. I'm like, okay, when I call out Haney, I'm not calling him out to beat him. I'm calling him out to say I ain't got enough. So what I'm going to do as a robot, I'm going to self-destruct. You know, yeah. So I gave him a little self-destruction music in there. Now, mind you, you mentioned DVD, and as we were doing, I had to make that video. I mean, make that pose routine with that little cassette.
Yeah.
We didn't have no mixing and all that really? At the time. Remember that? Yeah. This is the little push the little drawer, put the little cassette in there, push record and talk. Cassette. You know. Okay, that's where that came from.
Was it made in a studio or is it just?
Nah,
really?
I did it at home first, but then I got to talk to a friend of mine who happened to be a radio guy. Okay. So I went to his home and he had some machines and stuff.
Yeah.
And he mixed up the voices for me, the voiceovers, using my voice. I'm just like, I told you I'll be back. You know, I mean, I had everything done myself. He pushed them together for me. Had a sound guy, a friend of his, made the sounds for me of the machine gun. Because I'm literally telling this guy, directing him, what I'm trying to do.
Yeah.
I said, can you make some robotic sounds for me as if I was searching the room? You know, how about me making some mechanical steps? I need something thunderous. I need something that's going to attract your attention.
Yeah.
I'm going to load my weapons, you know. Give me something I can do-do-do-do-do-do. I'm like, you know, like, piecework this. And it came out. It came out so good. It was like, look at this.
Classic.
But here's the thing. Here's the thing. You're going to try this? You're going to call these guys out? And you never beat them? How are you going to look?